Hello, and welcome back to EWTN News' ongoing coverage of the Pan-Amazonian Synod. I'm Matthew Bunson with EWTN News, and here we are in the middle of week two of the Pan-Amazonian Synod. And there's a lot to talk about, but one of the things that people are continuing to discuss, because it's a bit of a controversy, is an event that took place even before the Synod started. And that was on October 4th in the Vatican Gardens on the Feast of St. Francis of Assisi, and a kind of ritual that was held with Pope Francis in attendance that we're still a little hazy about, and hopefully we'll get a little more clarity from my guest today. But it has raised interesting questions as well about what else is happening in the city and also in the Synod Hall and its ramifications for where we go from here. To help us understand more about all of this, I'm joined by J.D. Flynn once again, Editor-in-Chief of the Catholic News Agency.
Hey, Matthew. Thanks so much for having me.
So we're still talking about this event in the Vatican Gardens, a lot of controversy that has surrounded it, in part because of statues. A lack of clarity as to what exactly those statues represent.
Right.
And now that has some effect in raising questions about other events in the city.
Yeah, that's right. So the October 4th tree planting event was an event that involved indigenous Amazonians and their friends and allies. They planted a tree in the Vatican Gardens. And they also had a ceremony that involved two statues of sort of one-dimensional carved statues of naked pregnant women. And those statues were not quite explained. One of them, you might remember, was presented to the Pope, and it may have been that the woman who presented it to the Pope referred to the statue as Our Lady of the Amazon, and generally they were understood to be sort of Marian icons. And those statues have appeared in other events. There's a series of events. They're called Moments of Amazonian Spirituality going on at a church just down the street from St. Peter's. And the statues have continued to appear there. I've been going most days, and they've been there. And there's been controversy because some people have said, well, these are statues of Mary. But other people have asked whether or not they have their roots in the indigenous religious traditions and practices of the Amazonian people, and if so, if they're sort of appropriate to use in a Christian context.
Understanding the difference is crucial,
right,
because we're talking about an event in the Vatican.
Right, exactly. Not only in the Vatican, but the events that have been taking place each day are taking place in a church.
And of course, the church is Santa Maria in Transpontina, which is only yards away from the St. Peter's Basilica.
Right. It's a Carmelite church, 500 years old, just down the street from St. Peter's Basilica. And a church, you know, in Catholic theology and canon law is dedicated and reserved for sacred worship. And so people have asked if these symbols are not Christian, that are at the center of this ritual, if these rituals are traditional rituals that don't have a Christian meaning, what are they doing in a church? That's been a cause of confusion and scandal. That kind of came to a head yesterday because some Vatican spokespersons were asked what they thought was going on, and they said, as have others in the past, well, the statues aren't precisely Marian or precisely pagan. They're symbols of life, and we'll find out some more information. And I think the scandal has come from many Catholics sort of wondering, why are these events taking place if we don't quite know what they are? Why would there be, just yards from the Vatican or in the Vatican Gardens, a ceremony, a ritual, if you will, that that the Church can't explain and understand and point to its Christian meaning and identity?
So these decorations that were then moved to Santa Maria in Transpontina have continued to raise anxiety levels of people. What does church law say specifically about using a church in this fashion?
Right, yeah. So canon law defines that a sacred space, a church, an oratory, a chapel, is reserved for Christian worship. And ordinarily that means the holy sacrifice of the Mass and other devotional practices and other sacramental practices. And it's certainly true that any number of devotions take place in a church, that there would be the recitation of the rosary or preaching or adoration of the Blessed Sacrament, 40 hours devotion, those kinds of things. And so, again, if these rituals are manifestly Christian, then church law would say that they belong in a church. But if they're a cultural expression that is not a Christian expression, even if they don't have other religious meanings, the church would say, well, cultural expressions don't generally take place in a church. Now, there is the practice in some cultures, including American culture, that you might have a sort of concert of classical music in a church. But generally, when that happens, the Blessed Sacrament would be reserved, would be taken away and reserved elsewhere, and there would be some clarity that the space has been prepared for essentially a secular event.
To use precise terms, especially canonically, but also theologically and liturgically, what constitutes a pagan ritual in these circumstances?
Right. Well, yeah, a pagan ritual would be one that is oriented towards the devotion or worship or honoring or homage of traditional indigenous gods, traditional religious gods, which we have in all cultures, right? I mean, our own sort of ethnic backgrounds have their own mythology and ethnic gods, but something dedicated to their devotion or worship. And that's certainly what many people have suggested might be happening here. I think we should be careful about jumping to that conclusion, because what we know right now is that the Vatican doesn't know. And that's, I think, enough to give a lot of people pause. And there's certainly the suggestion that this statue has these religious significance for indigenous religious communities. And that, I think, has been a source of scandal for people. There has been, I think, ample desire on the part of many journalists to give the Vatican the chance to explain what's happening, to give the benefit of the doubt and an opportunity to explain what's happening. But the scandal, I think, is that right now we still don't have answers. In fact, we have more ambiguity each time the question is raised.
In the time we have left, what do we know about those who actually are in charge of organizing this?
Right. So these events are part of something called the Casa Comune Initiative. And it's organized
by a common home, basically.
Right, a common home. Exactly, yeah. That's right. It's organized by a sort of consortium of groups. REPAM, which is the Pan-Amazonian Activist Network that's connected to the Latin American Bishops Conference, a social justice group based in Brussels. And then the funding has come from some aid organizations connected to the German Bishops Conference. So we've got this sort of multinational activist groups that are officially connected to the church in some ways, and then in other ways unofficially connected.
Right. And we know that there's a lot of money that has been pouring into the Amazon over the years from the German bishops' aid organizations.
Right, that's right. Yeah, and so the influence of that money, you know, of course, the German bishops right now are mired in their own set of scandals about the synod that they'd like to hold on moral issues and theological issues at the beginning of Advent. And so it just seems like there's sort of a preponderance of at least questions, or if not sort of suspicious and concerning issues here.
And a couple of the topics the German bishops are addressing, one of them happens to be whether or not clerical celibacy as a discipline should be maintained.
Which, of course, is being talked about here, as well as the ordination of women, and they say a new look at sort of the church's sexual morality. So that has caused controversy here in Rome and in Germany as well.
I look forward to further reporting from the Catholic News Agency as to what the answers might be and where they might lead us.
If we get answers, we'll report them, Matthew, I promise.
Awesome.
Thanks so much.
Thanks, J.D. Flynn with the Catholic News Agency. Well, and thank you again for tuning in, and we promise that there will be more reporting on this subject, especially as the Synod goes on, as we probe deeper into questions of enculturation, evangelization, and of course, the very probody. Until next time, however, please continue to pray for the Synod Fathers, for our Holy Father, and say a small prayer for all of us at EWTN News as we continue to cover the Pan-Amazonian Synod. I'm Matthew Bunson. Until next time, God bless.